probably wouldn't have much heartburn on moving the test to Wednesday if you wanted to. Later's preferred to. It's kind of like a present value calculation, really, except for sometimes you may want to be pushed into it. But I'm okay going to Wednesday. Then we can have you turn in this homework over the weekend, too, and we can talk about it then. But we'll be moving into some of the next material. However, before we do that, Chelsea, I looked at that problem a little closer, and there was only one issue with it. So if you've got your books, maybe I'll but it was smaller than I thought it was. But I think this wouldn't be a bad little problem to work through. You're gonna do it as homework too. So we can just kind of think of this as a little kickstart to your homework. So you've got a familiar table of numbers. This, by the way, is really not much different than principal's class, so no big surprises here on having a table of numbers with costs, revenues. We generated a similar table of numbers in principal's class. But the answer key in back looked like it was a little off. And it was a little off, but not a lot off. So how do we go about starting this table? So the opening part says, that I don't have quite shown here, Nancy sells beeswax in a perfectly competitive market. Ding, 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 ding. What does that mean? Price taker, price equals marginal revenue equals demand, right? Nancy's fixed costs are $15, and Nancy's capable of producing up to 6 pounds per year. Use that information to fill in the table below. Hint, total variable cost is simply the sum of marginal costs of a particular quantity of output. So, when you're staring at a table like this, what's some things that help you fill it in? Marginal revenue, okay. How are you filling it in? Same as the price. So you could just take it from the information we had. It's the same as the price and fill it down. So price equals marginal revenue. There's a total revenue column here. So how would we calculate that? Price times quantity. Not anything with cost at this point. But so total revenue from our profit equation. Price times quantity. So this would end up going, what's our first entry? 50, 100, 150, 200. So it's going up by 50 each time. Marginal revenue is change in total revenue derived by from a change in quantity. So a couple different ways to remember that. It's a price taker, it's always equal. Or we go back to this definition, it's changing by 1 each time. Change in total revenue is 50 over 1. Right? So that's 50 across the board. Marginal cost is given to us. Now, how do we start getting into the cost side of life? How do we start getting into the cost? Oh, I remember that did that before, and I apparently don't need to. Okay, fixed costs. Boom, 15. That's a good one. What else? Good question. Is it? Variable cost divided by quantity. Let me just, as you're talking, total variable cost divided by quantity. Is that marginal cost? That's average variable, good. So we're chipping away at a few things here. What else? Change in what, John? All right, so if we change that to change in variable, then we do have marginal cost, which is also equal to the change in total cost over the change in quantity. So there's kind of our two different ways to come in to get to marginal cost. Okay, so back to the table again. What does that mean for filling in the blanks here? Okay, good. So you're saying you want to put what in here? Is that what I'm hearing you say? You want to put something in there? Yeah. How are you? So just talk it through. What are you plugging?
Would it be 30 plus 15?
30 plus 15 is the variable cost?
Total cost.
Okay. So what's the variable cost?
30,
which is kind of what I thought you were wanting to say. Now, the answer though is that the answer is no in general. It's right for this problem. Why is it right for this problem that this number is 30? That is correct for this problem, but not for every problem I might throw you on an exam. Because it changed by one. That's right. So if this had been 0, 10, 20, 30, there would have been 10 units that were coming at us at a $30 per unit basis. And the number would have been like 300.
Yeah, then we would divide by the quantity.
Yes. Yeah, so you divide by the quantity to get it on a per unit basis. So, because this is total variable cost. So that's why I say for this particular problem, it turned out the change in Q was 1, so it worked. And so, but I don't want you to think that that's the way it works. You need to kind of fall back on all of your nuts and bolts over here to verify that. So just don't memorize that. Well, this one's always equal to this one. It's not. We're missing one other key thing when you see a table like this. You guys started off okay here. Total variable cost. How about this box? 0. 0 quantity, 0 variable cost, by definition. So total cost is 15, meaning if we shut down, we still have $15 worth of cost, right? So then what's this number? How much? 35, no.
50.
No. Somebody give me the interpretation of this 35 over here. Somebody run down. Okay, be a little more specific. Instead of saying that much cost, go ahead and use the word 35. For the, what's that, Rianne? For the second unit. The second unit cost me 35. So what's this box? 65. The first unit cost me 30, which was that number happened to be that column. But again, we're not replicating this column. That's the cost of each additional unit. So two units, the first one cost me 30, the second one cost me 35, so this is 65. What's this number then? Now we're getting more challenging with the math in your head. 107, right? So 65 plus 42, 107. So this is the cost of each additional unit moving forward. So then you start to fill in the whole table. Now, let's get to the mistake in the answer key. How does a firm, well, I guess let's kind of generically go through. I'm going to let you guys fill in the table later when you work on it. But the first problem is, If Nancy is interested in maximizing total revenue, how many pounds of beeswax should she produce? 6, good. The key in the back says profit. So that was part A in the back of your answer key says Nancy should produce 6 pounds of beeswax to maximize profit. That was the screw up, Chelsea. The question asks for revenue, but then the way they worded the answer key, it says profit. So just mental note, they're asking for revenue, so the correct answer is 6, like you guys just said, produce as much as you can to maximize revenue, which is typically the case, unless you get into the inelastic portion of the demand curve, which then as you produce more units, your revenue will start to fall. But otherwise, keep producing more and your revenues climb. That's the normal relationship, so max it out. A lot of business owners make that mistake all the time. They think about money in the cash register rather than the profit at hand. It might be better to back off in some cases. Second mistake in the answer key. The question's fine. What quantity of beeswax should Nancy produce in order to maximize her profit? We didn't fill in the whole table. In general, how does Nancy maximize profit? Marginal revenue equals marginal cost. So down here, this one turns out to be 50. Well, we know that. This was 50 all the way down. So it's right here, produce 4 units. In the answer key, it says Nancy's maximum profit is $28. That's not what I came up with unless I was, let me double check my work here. Yeah, I had a hunt. Oh, yeah, I did screw up. Okay, that's correct. That's correct. Okay. So answer key's fine. So the answers are, the only, no, the tables, I'll get to that. Okay. So in fact, let's just skip down. Well, no, let's just work, I guess, we're this far into it. Part D, C and B are kind of related to each other. D, suppose that Nancy's fixed costs suddenly rise to 30. How should Nancy alter her production to account for the sudden increase in her fixed cost? How should she change? She shouldn't change. Marginal cost doesn't change. Variable cost, not fixed cost. So you're going to get the same answer. Nancy should produce 4 units. Fixed cost. Now, what is the implication of her fixed cost going up, though? Profit's going to fall, right? So anytime we dump on more costs, whether it's variable or fixed, our profit's going to fall. But remember, it's the profit maximizing or loss minimizing quantity. It's always going to be the best answer for us. Now, Chelsea, back to your last thing here. So that table in the back is in response to part E. Whoops. I'm not sure how much it. Did it move it forward? Yeah. Should be fine. Okay. So part E says, now let's have some union bargains for higher wages causing the marginal cost to rise by $8 at every output level. So if costs go up by $8, what happens to the table? So it says, causing cost to go up by $8 at every output level. The marginal cost goes up. So we just go 38, we add 8 to each one of these numbers, and then that's going to add 8 to this one and switch our profit maximizing quantity to being 3. And so then that table adjusted all those numbers. So it was all related to part E is why the table looked weird and kind of off. Okay, well, a good exercise to go through, you know, we spent time with equation goggles on. We've kind of talked through the graphing goggles. This is schedule goggles. So now we've kind of completed the whole package for perfect competition. All right, any other questions there? Okay. Well, since we're bumping the test, I was going to do some review this morning, but we'll just save that for Monday after you guys get your problems done. So that'll work out better anyway. So we'll move into Monopoly. So, what was the deal with Monopoly? Fire away. Barriers or restricted entry and exit. Barriers to entry. All right, somebody else other than Kate? Price makers. All right, so that's true. Okay, let's just kind of brainstorm a little bit. I'll tie some things together. What else other than Brinson and Kate? What's that? One firm. Okay, what else? What type of product? It's kind of a little weird, but it's going to bring up a topic that I want to talk about that we didn't hit as hard in principles class. So, with perfect competition, what was true about all of the firm's production of the product? It was the same product. So, we had a homogeneous product. So, with Monopoly, we have a homogeneous product kind of by definition because there's only one firm. It's a homogeneous product for a single product monopolist. What we'll now get into a little bit more than what we had in the past is a multi-product monopolist. So we could have a multi-product monopolist. And the multi-product could come in the other competitive structures too, like monopolist to competition. So just wanted to raise that issue, that it's possible there could be multiple products that the firm with control is offering without any competition. So, on our competition spectrum, we go from perfect competition to no competition. It's our two extremes. All right. What's the implication? Let's expand on Brinson's price maker. What does that mean in terms of for the firm and decision making and maybe how we model it? There's one thing that the price making thing brings up. Might tie it back to our old picture of perfect competition. We had something like this, and then we had the drop of water in the bucket, the representative firm. You know, that was our picture. Representative firm, and we had the market. Price taker, talk to me about this price maker business. Yeah. What is that one curve? Yes, I think your gut is leading you in the right direction. What's the deal with Monopoly related to the price maker? There's this one curve and it's kind of half of another curve. Does that help spark anybody else's memory from principles class? This is this principal stuff. Marginal revenue is, how does it look?
Twice as steep as
demand. That's the, is that what you were going with? All right, so back to this picture, what's really going on is there's only one firm. So this was kind of a consequence or an artifact of being just a drop of water in the bucket with no power, right? Farmer Joe's corn was no different than Farmer Tom, Dick, and Harry. And so they were a price taker, leading to a perfectly elastic demand curve. But if you're the only show in town, the firm, the monopoly, faces the market demand curve and now has some pricing power due to that, or and some pricing decisions that are a little different. So I guess to kind of play off of what I've got drawn here, the monopolist faces the market demand curve. Making it, him or her or it, if it's a company, making it a price maker. So that's where the whole price maker business comes from, is if they reduce quantity, they can raise price, right? They're facing the whole downward sloping market demand curve. Copy of this morning, so let's just throw it up on the screen. So, Babe's Bats sells baseball bats for children around the world. The firm faces a demand curve where Q is measured in thousands of bats, P is dollars per bat, and there's a marginal cost curve. So, solve for the profit maximizing level of output, show the firm's profit maximization decision. So, how does a firm maximize profit, I guess, is the first thing for part A. Any different than Farmer Tom, Dick, or Harry? No. So, produce the quantity where the revenue generated by the last unit is equal to the cost of the last unit. Okay, so now we got a little extra challenge here. I want you to graph out this demand curve. So let's start by graphing the demand curve. It doesn't ask for this to be done, but graph it in our normal price on the vertical axis, quantity on the horizontal space. What'd you get for the functional form of the inverse demand curve? Negative 4 Q plus, what'd you say, 4? So Q equals 12.5, what am I at here? Oh, that's 10. 10 minus 0.4 P. Over here equals 10 minus Q, right? 4 tenths, 10 fourths, P equals 10 times 10 fourths minus 10 fourths Q. So we get 10 times 10 is 100. So what'd you get? A little louder. Graphically, what's it look like? Vertical intercept, 25. And then we got a down 2.5, over 1, down 2.5, over 1. What's this horizontal intercept? Equals zero, sounds good. All right, so there's our demand curve. What is its implication on marginal revenue? Because to solve the profit maximizing quantity, we need to produce where marginal revenue equals marginal cost. What does this marginal cost curve look like? Marginal cost equals 5Q. Where does it start? Zero. Okay. And slope of 5. Up 5 over 1, up 5 over 1. By the time we get to 10, where are we at? 50. Oh, I guess I was roughly keeping my stuff in line here. We got some sort of marginal cost curve simplification that it's just linear, looking something like that. All right, do we figure out where these two cross? And that's our answer. No, why? Because why? Not the marginal revenue. All right, so why is it not the marginal revenue? Doesn't it tell me that if I want to sell one unit, all I need to do is drop my price 2.5, I go down to 22.5, and I can sell one unit. So that seems like it's my marginal revenue. My marginal revenue is from one unit is the 250. I think we might have a little issue with thousands of units and stuff here, aren't we? It's actually a thousands. But that's okay. We can just think about it, incremental units at this point. But so I sell 2. Aren't I just going down to 20? Is it the revenue generated by the second unit, 20, isn't it this line? So what's the revenue generated by the first unit? 2250. Revenue generated by the second unit? 20?
No.
That's the trick. If I shouldn't even call it a trick, but I'm just going to say the catch. So why is the revenue generated by the second unit not 20? For the second unit, in order to get the second unit off the shelves, they did have to charge 20. But it's not representing the revenue generated by the second unit. Nope, not related to marginal cost. Strictly sticking on the revenue side right now.
Would you have to multiply the area?
We could start to go towards areas, but we don't need to. Got to lower the price of the first one is all we're looking for. So in order to sell two units that are homogeneous, not only do I have to lower the price to get the second one sold, but I'm lowering the price for all the previous units too. If I can't do what? Price discrimination. That's the price discrimination argument. All right, so this is dusting the cobwebs. This is all principle stuff at this point, but these are important to think about as we get into price discrimination and advanced pricing in some future chapters. This is a lot of what it comes back to. So we're going to call this guy a single price monopolist. They can only charge one price for the product, or on the flip side, they can't price discriminate. If they can't price discriminate, then what is the revenue generated by the second unit, taking into account the fact that you got to lower the price for all previous units? Who's got their thinking cap on, a little arithmetic? The second one I'm going to sell at a price of 20, I'm not doubting that, but the revenue generated by it isn't 20, it is how much?
Money
minus the loss from the first. Now that's where you could get into a little bit of areas if your brain is working that way. How else could we start thinking about this? Total revenue at quantity of 1 equals how much?
22.50.
1 unit, 1 price. Total revenue associated with producing 2 units? Total revenue associated with producing 2 units? 4D, yes. Price times quantity. Both units are being sold at a price of 20, the single price, right? So it's just telling us, hey, if you go to the consumers with 2 units, the most they're gonna pay you is 20 bucks a unit. If you wanna sell more, you're gonna have to drop your price even further, which then distorts or changes the marginal revenue. So total revenue associated with 2 units is 40, and therefore the marginal revenue is the change in total revenue derived from a change in units of output, giving you $17.50. Now back to your area thing. That other 20, I lost this 250 worth of area. Conceptually, you can think of it this way if you're thinking about those areas. My total revenue is this rectangle, but I didn't get to keep this little guy here, which represents $2.50. So the revenue in total was not 20 that I got for the second unit, the price I sold it for, minus the 250 gives me my 1750 answer that I was just deriving here. All right, so marginal revenue is 1750. A couple different ways to think about it. I lost this area. If you guys, I would encourage you to actually highlight that area. The reason is that when it comes back to price discrimination, that ends up being some extra profit that you can take advantage of if you can price discriminate. So this is, in this case, it's additional revenue that you're picking up for free because it's not costing you anymore, right? It's just purely on the revenue side. So that represents the lost revenue on the previous units. So finally, if we graph this sucker out, at 2 units, I've got $1,750 worth of revenue. So this big green dot represents 1 point on the marginal revenue function. Okay. So that's where we start getting this thing being twice as steep and lying below the demand curve. So let me write that out. So marginal revenue is twice as steep, twice the slope. Now that we're going to go back to equation goggles here shortly, 2 times the slope, which is going to be convenient when we put our equation goggles back on. Marginal revenue is twice as steep, 2 times the slope, with the same vertical intercept. So twice as steep as the demand curve. Marginal revenue is twice as steep with the same vertical intercept when compared to demand. And actually, let me put a little more carefully the inverse demand curve. You got to be doubling the right thing. So back to this equation, which is our inverse demand curve. How do we reflect the marginal revenue function?
Minus 5Q.
So that's it. Now you got your information here to calculate A. Show the firm's profit maximizing decision graphically. Those two lines are going to cross where? What's that? No. Where is this going to happen? We can solve for that now. Because we've got a marginal cost curve. What do we end up getting? First person who's got it, spit it out. Negative 5Q is 2 times, this is the demand curve. So the marginal revenue curve, I didn't write it out. The marginal revenue curve is equal to 25 minus 2 times the slope. Same vertical intercept, 2 times the slope gives us minus 5Q. Q equals what?
2.5.
Yeah. So 5Q, marginal cost equals marginal revenue. 10Q equals 25. Q equals 2.5. So Q equals 2.5. What price should they charge? What price should they charge? $18.75. How'd you get that? Into the inverse demand curve, right? So you're not going where the two lines cross. We're going to charge the highest price people are willing and able to pay for it. So our old monopoly graph, if I can just draw it a little generically here, you should. The trick that we used in principles class was that the marginal revenue curve bisects the horizontal axis equal distance between where the demand curve comes into play. So in this problem, it would have been 5. And generic marginal cost curve looks like this. Produce the quantity where the revenue generated by the last unit produced is equal to the cost of the last unit. Charge the highest price people are willing and able to pay. And Curtis came up with $18.75 at a quantity of 2.5. How much profit is the firm making? How much profit is the firm making?
When producing at that point?
Yes. So producing at 2.5 using the numbers we just used. How much profit is the firm making?
From
22.5
down.
So I'm looking for a number. How much profit is the firm making? We calculated the profit maximizing quantity and the profit maximizing price. How much profit is the firm earning? $6.25. Price was what? $18.75. Yeah, you'd have to be careful with the quantity. So what'd you get? Yeah, that would be the adjustment. How much profit? $6,250. Did everybody get that?
How do we get the cost? The
total cost? Yeah, how do you get the total cost?
What are you saying?
Like, this profit is total revenue minus total cost, so how do you...
Okay. John, how did you get total cost? Okay. Ah, ding, 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 dang. Not enough information to calculate it. So your gut was right. I couldn't quite tell if your gut was going or if you just didn't see this or what, but you got there. Good. There's not enough information to calculate profits because all we have is variable costs, right? Filling in that table, all we have is the variable cost. We don't have any information on fixed costs. We do know that this firm is doing the best that they can, producing 2.5 units and charging a price of $18.75, but we actually don't know if they're making money or losing money. But they're doing the best that they can. We don't have information on their fixed costs. Okay, well that looks like a good place to wrap up for today.